So now we come to the celebrated results of Brouwer, namely Jordan Brouwer. Jordan Brouwer separation theorem, and then using that we will prove the Jordan Brouwer's invariance of domain also. I would like to tell you that in part one we had already proved the Brouwer's invariance of domain directly using cellular simplicial approximation theorem and Sperner lemma. But we could not prove Jordan Brouwer separation theorem there. Okay, so here we are proving Jordan Brouwer separation theorem first, and then using that we will prove the Jordan Brouwer's invariance of domain. So this has completely a different approach, and historically the Brouwer more or less came with these ideas of developing homology just to prove this invariance of domain theorem, one might say. So the idea, basic idea of the proof that we are going to present is more or less as in Brouwer's original paper, 1911. So let me state them together because they go hand in hand in some sense, though they are quite, statements are quite different. So Jordan Brouwer separation theorem is an extension of Jordan's Jordan curve theorem for S1 contained in S1 embedded inside in the complex plane R2. Okay, so such a thing is called a Jordan curve theorem, Jordan loop, which means 1-1 mapping of S1. You know, 1-1 continuous mapping of S1 into R2. Okay, so this theorem was a what can I say, a sensation at that time, because after defining what is the meaning of continuous function, lots of weird examples were constructed by many mathematicians. Continuous functions like Antoni's and what is called as pianos curves, which were continuous functions from closed interval, but they were filling up the whole of space, not only just I cross I, but I cross I, countably many times also. And there are many other kinds of weird examples, nowhere differentiable continuous functions and so on were there by Weierstrass. So this came as a pleasant surprise, but his own proof, Jordan's proof, was rejected by people, contemporary people. Later on it was Veblen who gave a proof that was accepted. After that, several people have given several so-called proofs. Okay, why are they so-called? Most of them are wrong, but some of them are right. Okay, there are different proofs of this one also. Some of them are right. Okay, here we are not proving that special case separately. We are going to prove it directly. We are going to prove the n-dimensional version of that, namely an n-1 sphere embedded in an n sphere separates it into exactly two components. These two components have their common boundary as the embedded n-1 sphere. So this is the statement. Jordan Brouwer, that is Jordan Brouwer separation theorem. The Brouwer invariance of domain says that if you have U and V are any two subspaces of R2 homeomorphic to each other, if U is open, then V is also open. So that is the meaning of invariance of domain, homeomorphic invariance of domain. One is open, the other one must be open. They must be subspaces of the same Rn. Okay. So towards the proof of this, we will state two lemmas which are themselves give you a better picture of what is going on. Okay. Sometimes the lemmas can be quoted and used elsewhere than the theorems. So these are quite interesting lemmas. So first lemma 4.6 says that take a subset of Sn which is homeomorphic to a closed interval cross itself k times. Instead of the sphere, it is a disk. So I am taking the square model here. So you can take Ritz disk model, no problem, it's homeomorphic. Homeomorphic to IK, where K is between 0 and N. Like you can take a point, or you can take an arc, K equal to 1, or you can take a square, and so on. Any kind of homeomorphic picture. So it need not be, you know, rectangle even. It need not be twisted and so on. Fine. Then the reduced homology groups of Sn minus A all vanish. You know that if you throw away one point from Sn, it's contractible, so reduced homology vanishes. Okay? So this is a far-reaching generalization of that phenomenon. Sn minus A, you don't know whether it's contractible or not. I can say that all the reduced homology groups are trivial. No matter what it is, A is homeomorphic to IK is all that I need. Okay? So I would say that this lemma itself is quite useful. Okay? So the next thing is, now suppose B is a subset of Sn homeomorphic to Sk. Okay? For some k between 0 and n minus 1. Then the reduced homology groups of Sn minus B, I mean, you are throwing away B, and what is left out? These are all zero except in one single dimension. So H tuple of N minus K minus 1 of Sn minus B is that. Okay. So this is also of importance in many knot theory problems and so on. All right. So what we are going to do is first we prove these two lemmas. Okay. So first we assume these two lemmas and complete the proof of these two theorems. Then we will prove this 4.7 first. Okay. Which is easier, though this is a little more complicated statement. The crux of the matter, this one will come later. The lemma 4.6, which is a very foundational result, one would say. Okay, so that's the plan. All right. So granting 4.6 and 4.7, we shall prove this 4.15 and 4.16 theorem. Okay. So 4.15 first, namely Jordan Brouwer separation theorem. Take B be a subset of Sn homeomorphic to Sn minus 1. We have to show that Sn minus B has exactly two components to begin with. And then those two components means what? Connected components, path connector, whatever. U and V, call them boundary of u must be equal to boundary of v must be equal to b. This is what we have to show. Okay. Now look at the above lemma. What is this lemma? Lemma is one. B is homeomorphic to Sk, where k is equal to n minus 1. Right? So put that h twiddle of n minus 1 minus 1. Okay. So that will be h naught. H naught twiddle is isomorphic to z. H naught twiddle is isomorphic to z means h naught is isomorphic to z direction z, which is the same thing as saying h naught. What is h naught? Is that times z means what? That the space has exactly two connected components. Okay, so very easy proof. So h naught twiddle of Sn minus b is z, and this implies Sn minus b has precisely two components. Let us call them u and v. Now elaborately, now you have to show that both u and v are open subsets. By definition, boundary of u, which is u bar minus interior of u. Okay, but interior of u is u itself, u bar minus u. Similarly, boundary of v is v bar minus v. We have to show that boundary of v itself is boundary of u equal to boundary of v. This is what we have to show. Okay, so v is open and disjoint from u. Okay, u union v union b will be the whole space. That is very clear. So no point of v, because v is open, is in the closure of u, because u is disjoint from v. Okay, so you take a point of v, v itself is a neighborhood, it doesn't intersect u, therefore it is not a boundary point. Therefore, boundary of u is contained inside b. Okay, it is not inside u, because by definition boundary of u is u bar minus u. So there is a chance that it may be inside v. If it's not there also, the rest of the thing is just boundary b, because u, v and b together, all the three things form our space Sn. Okay, this is pure set theory. So boundary of u is inside b, one way we have to. So now the point is, we have to show that b is inside boundary of u. Every point of b is a closure point of u, is what I have to show. Then I am done. Once I show its closure point, okay, it is not a point of u by the very definition, so it must be inside b, inside a boundary. Okay, so B is contained inside boundary will be proved if you show that every point of B is a closure point of U. By symmetry, once I show it for you, it will be true for V also. Okay, this is the same as showing that any arbitrary small neighborhood N of B, take a point B inside the boundary of B. Okay, intersects U bar. If it every neighborhood intersects U bar, then you are done. Okay, so inside a neighborhood, whenever you have a neighborhood of a point, we can find a neighborhood N1 of B in B. Okay, what is B? B is homeomorphic to Sn minus 1. Remember that. So you can take a neighborhood and use the homeomorphism and come to Sn minus 1. So there will be a neighborhood of Sn minus 1 going inside that neighborhood by continuity, right? So you can find a neighborhood N1 of B such that B is actually union of N1 and N2. Okay, and both NIs are homeomorphic to IN minus 1. In other words, what I am doing is, I am taking N1 to be a small disk around this point. Okay, the complement will be also a disk. Inside a sphere, if you take a small disk, okay, the complement will be also homeomorphic to a disk. Okay, so B is a union of N1 and N2, and both NIs are homeomorphic to one dimensional lower, sorry, is the same dimension, is there Sn minus 1, so it is In minus 1. Okay. In minus 1 or a disk, dn minus 1, doesn't matter. Okay, I am using the square model here, in minus 1. Okay, here is a picture. So this green thing could be the, so this picture is after all n equal to 1, n equal to 2. And B is a circle, B is the curve, and we are working inside a sphere. Okay. Same thing as working inside R2. Okay, this picture is for a curve inside R2. So this is the curve, all this along with this green part. And I have taken a point here, B on the, where? On the curve, on the B. This is B, right? On the curve. I want to show that every neighborhood of that will intersect U, inside U bar. Of course, in picture is obvious. So that's the problem. You should not use a picture to conclude something. Only what are the hypotheses so far? Keep track of that, that's all. So there's a neighborhood, there's a point B. I have to show that this neighborhood intersects U bar. Okay, so what I have chosen is this N1 is homeomorphic to IK minus 1, its complement is also homeomorphic to IK minus 1. In minus 1, and k is n here. Okay. So now the previous lemma 4.6 says that Sn minus n2, this portion, which is homeomorphic to a disk, okay, this is contractible. This has reduced homology all to zero. Okay. In particular, H naught of that is Z, or H twiddle, H naught twiddle is zero. So that's connected. So if you throw away only this part N2 from Sn, that will be still connected. That is the first lemma. Okay. So Sn minus 2 is path connected because H naught twiddle is zero. Okay. So we take P, two points, P belong to U and Q belong to V. Okay, one is in here, one is there. All right, point is U and V, and join them by a path. This path lying in Sn minus N2, because this PQ are in Sn minus N2. What is N2? N2 is a part of B. So I have taken points U and V outside this part, N2, as well as outside B itself, okay, they are inside U and V. Therefore, I can join them a pi by Sn minus N2. So that is path connected. But U and V are in different components of Sn minus B. Therefore, you cannot join them in Sn minus B. But this path is there. Where it is? It is in Sn minus N2. Therefore, it must intersect N1. The path, whatever you have taken, omega, must intersect N1. So let us say I have parameterized from P to Q. Okay. Omega 0 is P, omega 1 is this one. There will be a first time, the first T, for which WT will be on this N1, on this green part. Okay, which is the least element, okay, or whatever, among us, t between 0 and 1, for which omega t will belong to n1. That omega t, whatever the point, is obviously in the closure of U. You said that this must be in the closure of U. Okay. What does that mean? my whatever n I have chosen, it will be inside n1, but the whole n1 is inside n. Okay, this n intersects u bar. Every point B has a neighborhood n which intersects u bar. That's what we have shown. So that completes the proof of Jordan-Brouwer separation theorem. Now we come to Jordan-Brouwer separation theorem, Brouwer's invariance of domain theorem. So U and V are subspaces of Rn. By taking a one-point quantification, we can work inside Sn. There will be still open subsets of Sn also. They are subspaces of Sn. If one of them is open, I would show the other one is open. The only assumption we have is that U and V are homeomorphic. So let us fix a homeomorphism phi from U to V. Okay, now we are assuming that they are inside Sn. No problem. Okay. Now I have to show that V is open. Right? So take a point inside V, which I can always write it as y equal to phi x, where x itself is inside u. Okay. What I have to do? I must produce an open subset in Rn, or Sn actually, which is contained inside V and contains the point phi x. If this is true for every x, then why I have completed the proof that V is open. Okay, we should produce an open subset of Sn containing Y and contained in V. Okay, so now you see the Jordan-Brouwer separation theorem comes to help here. In a miraculous way, this great theorem will be proved now. Okay, so let A be a neighborhood of X in Sn, because U is open. That is the assumption. So take a neighborhood around X, namely, which is homeomorphic to a closed disk. Okay, and contained inside U. Okay, that you know that that is possible for every open subset of Sn as well as every open subset of Rn, whatever. Then its boundary of A is homeomorphic to Sn minus 1. If you apply phi, which is a homeomorphism from the whole of U into V, okay, phi of boundary of A, okay, that will be written as B. That will be a copy of Sn minus 1 because it is homeomorphic to Sn minus 1. And that is contained where? Contained inside Sn. Of course, it is contained inside V also now. Okay. By Jordan-Brouwer separation theorem, Sn minus B has precisely two components. And both components are obviously open subsets. Okay, look at A minus boundary of A, that is the inside of the disk. I have taken A to be a homeomorphic to a closed disk, right? A minus boundary of A is an open disk that is connected. And that will not intersect phi of this boundary of A, right? When you take phi of that. Therefore, phi minus A minus boundary of A, then this interior of that, okay, that must be a connected subset, okay, which is phi A minus B. Phi A minus B is connected. By lemma 4.6, Sn minus phi A is connected. Because phi A is what? A is a disk. So phi A is homeomorphic to a disk. The other lemma, the previous lemma, 4.6 says Sn minus phi A is connected. Okay? Okay, so far you have got the picture. On the other hand, Sn minus B is Sn minus phi A. B, remember, B is phi of boundary of A. Sn minus phi A union phi A minus B. It's a disjoint union because I have this phi A I have thrown away here. So here phi A is subset of phi A here. So this is Sn minus B. I can write it like this. Okay, it's a disjoint union like this. Okay, phi A is closed, Sn minus A is open. Okay, this B is closed. Of course, phi A minus B is semi-closed. It's an open subset of a closed set. Doesn't matter. It is disjoint. Okay, hence, these two sets must be the components of Sn minus B. There are only two components here. This whole set, and this is connected. This is connected. This is connected. The connected subsets, when you have separate, are contained inside this one, and there is a separation Sn minus B, they must go to one of them. And that's the whole thing. It is the whole of it. So they must be the components. Okay, so this is an elementary topological result that I am proving. You have a subset which is disjoint, which is a union of two connected components. Okay. You have written it in terms of in another way, namely as disjoint union of two connected sets. Okay. Then those two connected sets must be the components. There is nothing more than that here. Okay, this is already in a topology. Okay, hence these two sets must be the components of Sn minus B. But now components of Sn minus B, we know that they are open subsets. In particular, it follows that this phi A minus B is an open subset of Sn. So this would have been obvious. If you think Jordan-Caro theorem is obvious, but we have to prove it with all this elaborate way. Okay, phi A minus B is an open subset of Sn. Also, it contains the point Y because it contains phi X. And it's a subset of phi. Okay. Because phi, whole phi is from U to V. Okay. Thus, we have succeeded in producing an open subset. Okay. Around phi X actually contained in V. So this proves that V is open. So the two lemmas we will prove next time. So using the two lemmas, we have completed the proof of two big theorems. Okay? Thank you.